Bom dia a todos e a todas. Eu vou, na verdade, hoje pedir para o Luiz Eugênio fazer a apresentação do palestrante. Vou passar para ele. Alberto, thanks very much for accepting the invitation. Luiz, it's with you now.
Ok, Carol, muito obrigado. Bem-vindos todos e todas. Okay? A verdade é que a obtenção, né? Hoje Alberto vai falar sobre ímãs permanentes em terras raras. E a obtenção desse tipo de ímãs é uma das grandes preocupações existentes hoje em dia desde o ponto de vista estratégico, né? Devido a que tem uma grande importância tecnológica por suas aplicações na energia e no transporte. Asimismo, tem também importante impacto ambiental, e também desde o ponto de vista de sustentabilidade. A gente tem que ter em conta que a maioria desses materiais ou minerais onde saem as terras raras, todas elas estão concentradas em um único país que controla o mercado. Assim que hoje estou realmente contente e feliz de poder apresentar para vocês Alberto, nesta sessão de seminários do departamento, né? Isso para falar para vocês um pouco sobre Alberto. Ele estudou física na Universidade Complutense de Madrid. Durante seu doutorado, ele estudou ímãs permanentes nanocristalinos na IFW de Dresden. Ele fez postdoc na Universidade de Leipzig, né? Estudou propriedades magnéticas e de magnetotransporte em filmes finos. Depois teve uma fellowship de Marie Curie, né, no centro Spintec, no CEA, em Grenoble, onde ele trabalhou em sistemas com polarização de troca para aplicações espintrônicas e dispositivos sensores, que é onde a gente se conheceu. E depois foi pesquisador do Centro de Investigações Energéticas, Medioambientais e Tecnológicas de Madrid, onde estudou filmes flexíveis fotovoltaicos. Em 2012, Alberto estabeleceu o Laboratório de Ímãs Permanentes do IMDEA, que é o Centro de Madrid de Estudos Avançados em Nanociências, sendo o líder da divisão de ímãs permanentes e aplicações. E agora, ele é coordenador de vários projetos de pesquisa nacionais e internacionais, especialmente tem um projeto europeu, Passenger, que ele envolve 8 países europeus, tem 20 instituições participando, onde 14 são empresas, okay? E busca a implantação de laboratórios fábrica para obtenção de ímãs permanentes livres de elementos críticos de terras raras. Assim que vou deixar o Alberto com vocês para que fale mais do seu trabalho, porque eu realmente já estou muito impaciente por saber. Alberto.
Thank you very much for such a great introduction, Luis. I am wondering where did you get from so much information about me?
Have my
Wow.
means, yeah.
Of course, thank you very much also, Carol, and thank you to the complete department for this invitation. I am delighted of being here today to present you the work that we are doing at present, as Luis was commenting before, on permanent magnets, and to try to give you a flavor of the research part we are doing, and also the part of translation to industrial environment. Okay, so thank you again for the introduction. I will share the screen. Okay, so as I was mentioning before, the title of the presentation is trying to remark how is possible research, basic research, to be translated to industry. Okay, so it's something that sometimes physicists, well, chemists, I am talking about physicists because it's my case, we may find difficult to make the translation, but that translation is rather easy. First, when we manage to focus the research, the fundamental research that we are doing on different aspects, also to try to solve issues that some companies or some sectors or society in general, they may have. So in this case, as Luis was commenting before, there is a clear issue related to some specific permanent magnets. But first of all, I would like to make a short introduction, okay, on the topic. And since usually I leave this slide for the end, and now I have started to talk slowly as Luis is doing, but you will realize that I will start to get speed. Okay, so there will be a time where I will be talking very fast, and at the end I will not have the time to introduce something that for me is the most important part in a laboratory, and that is the group. So this is the group of permanent magnets and applications that I have the pleasure and the honor of leading. So you see that we are working on very three different research lines, okay? Rare earth free magnets. We are working also with hybrids, okay, of neo, neodymium iron boron magnets and ferrite. We are also touching the technological advance that can be done in production, okay? In this case, 3D printing technologies. And then also micromagnets fabrication, nanoparticles engineering, electrochemical synthesis, recycling, and also, as I was telling you before, very important to show that the advances that we are doing on a basic research part to translate it to functional devices, okay? So prototyping. So this is the group of people integrating the department, and also you see that we have recently integrated to Alejandro. Alejandro Martín, and they are coming also, they are joining very soon in the group, Andrés Martín Cid, and also Marta Hernández, that will start to do the PhD. First, as I was told that there will be some scientists, okay, or some young students that maybe they are not so familiar with permanent magnets, it is always very interesting to have a look to the orders of magnitude to understand what we are dealing with. So this is the magnetic field strength for the currents that are in our human brain, okay? If we go to the magnetic field generated by the Earth, we are talking already about 10 to the minus 5 Tesla. A magnet that you have usually on your refrigerator is already 10 to the minus 3 Tesla. These magnets are typically ferrite magnets, okay? Bonded ferrite magnets, so that means the ferrite powder is mixed with a plastic. Because of that, they are also, when you are talking with companies, they refer to them as plastic magnets. They don't go to the term of bonded magnet. And then we go to the permanent magnets, in particular to the case of neodymium iron boron. They are very strong, they're very powerful, and we are talking already of magnetic fields in the range of 0.1 to 1 Tesla. Okay? This is the main concept. A magnet can be considered as an energy storage device which provides a magnetic field in a particular volume of space. And that is what is making of interest, okay, these materials for technological applications. Thinking of magnets, I like showing this slide because usually when we have the visit of graduate students and you ask them about where do you find, okay, where do they find magnets, they always answer on the fridge. Okay, so this is the typical image that they have on permanent magnets, and of course also this distribution of the flux, magnetic flux lines, okay, that we can see here in a permanent magnet like the ones we used to play in school when we were kids. But of course, as we all know, applications of permanent magnets, they are all around us. We found them in many nowadays applications, and actually the application range is increasing on a yearly basis, especially driven by electric cars. Okay, well, let's say, because that is not correct. It's not electric cars, electric vehicles, okay? Because we are talking about large volume cars, okay, but also electric bikes, electric motorbikes, and also very important from renewable energy technology. Actually, if you have a look to a car, you may find the main mass, okay, of permanent magnets, they are in the motor, but you have also in all the appliances that you have in the car. As I used to say, everything that is moving in the car, the windows, the lights, the seats, everywhere there is a permanent magnet, usually making part of a sensor. So at the end, we have hundreds of permanent magnets in a car. Now, if you go to the wind turbines, you find a huge amount of neodymium iron boron magnets. Actually, in a 6 megabyte direct drive wind turbine, you find about 3.5 tons of permanent magnets. This is a lot. Moreover, now we are going to compare the quantity of neodymium iron boron magnets, let's say the mass of neodymium iron boron that we have in one of these motors of the wind turbine with the content in electric cars. And actually, it's the equivalent to 1,250 cars. Okay, in particular, this is for this hybrid car, okay, the Toyota Prius. So you can get an idea. I think it's always very important to get an image of the volume, okay, to get the importance that the material has in our daily, okay, applications. So it is extremely important. Ideally, this is the hysteresis loop, okay, the magnetic response that we are looking for a permanent magnet. Because of that, I was writing here the ID card of the permanent magnet. So typically, this gives you the image of how strong, how powerful is the magnet in terms of the magnetic energy. So ideally, we would like that is as broad as possible and as squared as possible. Of course, this is not the case because we have many factors, okay, that are preventing that the magnetic response has such a square response. Another important parameter that we need to take into consideration, and it will be important to understand some of the main results in this presentation, is the dependence of coercivity with the particle diameter. Okay? So actually that is defining as well the main applications that you have for your magnetic material. So you can be in the multi-domain region, and then you go through this single domain size. Okay, here is where we have the transition from a single domain in your particle to already the creation of domain walls, the division into different different domains, making a multi-domain configuration. So actually, in the case of permanent magnets, we are aiming to have single domain size in our particles when we want to optimize coercivity. Okay. Then of course you go when you are decreasing the particle size to the super paramagnetic region, which is very important, as you know, for applications like hyperthermia, okay, where you can use these nanoparticles to also charge them with some pharmacos and with some medicines in order to fight some diseases like cancer. Okay, so this is an image I wanted to show you. This. Now let's have a look to the historical evolution of permanent magnets. Of course, permanent magnets in the shape of this lodestone, which is magnetite, iron 3 or 4, iron oxide, is very well known by human beings since many centuries ago. Then in 1917, we have the appearance of cobalt steel magnets. But it is in 1930 when we have the appearance of alnico magnets. This is very interesting material. Okay, in terms of applications, the application area is very reduced because they demagnetize very easily. Okay, so actually, typical applications, they require that you have these magnets in the shape of rods. Okay, so the shape of the magnet is preventing possible demagnetization in the presence of a weak external magnetic field, because that is the problem, that they may become demagnetized in presence of a weak external magnetic field. And what is important about these magnets is what I write here, okay? This was meaning the beginning of a new way of thinking about magnetic materials. It was how to face the design of magnets based on composites, on creation of composites, okay? So this was making a revolution in this way of thinking in material science. Then in 1952, hexaferrites appear, okay? So strontium ferrite and barium ferrite, which actually are the most sold permanent magnets nowadays in terms of mass, okay? So these are the ones, you know, they are used very much in transformers and in other high volume applications. I will try to explain you during this presentation the possibility that they have to be integrated in other applications that usually they were relegated to neodymium iron boron magnets, but that is something that I will show you later. And for the students, I would like to remark, strontium ferrite, okay, or basically hexaferrite, okay, that is the correct name, hexaferrite, because strontium ferrite was discovered by Phillips, but the first hexaferrites, well, they were discovered in Japan, and it was actually an accident. It was a scientist working, he forgot to turn off the furnace, and during the morning, when he was coming back to the lab, he discovered that there was a magnetic behavior, strong magnetic behavior, which actually was attributed to this hard ferrite, okay, so discovered in Japan. So then, as I was telling you before, then hexaferrites, they were discovered by Phillips. Then samarium cobalt magnets appeared in 65, and then we go to the king of the permanent magnets. Okay, we should not forget that samarium cobalt magnets are also kings because they find applications where high temperatures are required. But usually you do not need to go to high temperatures, to very high temperatures, neodymium, iron, boron, they are doing greatly the job. As a colleague of us, and Luis will know him, Professor Jim Bojang, he was mentioning in an overview that he was doing during the conference last month ago. This, he was saying that is a gift from God, you know, because this permanent magnet material is so great, is so outstanding, okay, so stable, when you don't go, of course, above temperature, let's say, of about 160, 180 degrees Celsius. But the structure is so perfect that it is very possible to imagine that in the future, it can find an alternative to completely substitute these neodymium iron boron magnets. But actually, that is not our scope, okay? And it should not be the scope of any group working on permanent magnets, on trying to find alternatives. The idea is to find a market diversification. So in other words, not to use neodymium iron boron magnets everywhere, but only where really they are required, okay? And in other cases, to try to find substitutes that they can be produced with natural resources that are available in the different countries, okay? So that will bring this market diversification and sustainability that I was commenting before. So you get an idea of the evolution. In this illustration, you can see that each magnet is designed in such a way that they produce a field of 100 millitesla at 5 millimeters from the surface. So all of them at 5 millimeters, they are producing exactly this magnetic field of 100 milliteslas. So it's unbelievable the evolution that there has been over time in terms of this magnetic density power. Okay. Here you can see the historical evolution, the BH max, okay, maximum energy product in different units, because in the field of permanent magnets, and this we realize every time we have a meeting, okay, people from company and also from different countries, some of us are referring to megagauss or Oersted, other ones to kilojoules cubic meter. So here you have the evolution of both with the time, okay, with year. So basically what I would like to remark is since early 80s, when neodymium iron boron was discovered, all this area that you have here highlighted in red color is covered exclusively by rare earth-based permanent magnets. So it's unbelievable that since then we have not been able of finding, okay, a new permanent magnet that is not containing rare earths. And that is a problem. That is a problem because, as in the beginning of the presentation it was mentioned, the production is mainly concentrated in China. Luckily, over the last years, has been a distribution, okay, of this production in different countries, and different mines are open, or they are in the process of opening. In Canada, they are going to open a new mine at the end of the year, and they claim, okay, because you have listened before this, then sometimes they become reality, other times not, but they claim that they will be able of providing a large volume of rare earth, and in particular neodymium, okay, for the production of permanent magnets in Europe. Something that I am not clear yet is if that mine contains only neodymium or also dysprosium, because, and I tell you why, usually, and actually I don't know the case where both elements are together, you have mines for neodymium and mines for dysprosium, but it's very difficult to find mines where you have the combination of both elements. And where I also know, Luis was commenting me in the past, that there are plans to make a large-scale mining of rare earths in Brazil, because you have important natural resources. But basically what you see here is we have these large applications areas, and then we have here is the sales in million dollars during time for the different permanent magnets. So you see for neodymium iron boron in blue, okay, in red is for ferrite, and here you have the production over the years, okay, over time, and in blue is the material produced, the quantity of material produced by China. So there is a clear monopoly by China in the production of rare earths. So because of that, we need for innovative materials contributing to this diversification I was mentioning before. And there is also an issue related to the environmental impact, okay, that these rare earth elements they have. In particular, you can see this is an example of a mine in China. You have the location here on the bottom, okay? And here with these green stars is a remark the parts, okay, where all these residues they are going. So you have these two mines, and then all of these, they are the residues. So they are contaminating a lot, really a lot. And also there are some radioactive products like uranium that are resulting during the refinement of these rare earth elements. But important, and this is an important message, should we avoid mining of rare earth elements? And the answer is no. Common sense and responsibility should apply. Okay? We are growing every time more at a worldwide scale. We need a large need of these elements. Now we are referring to permanent magnets, as also for batteries, you know, there is also a problem there. So where there are resources, either in Europe, in Japan, in South America, they should be exploited. So there should not be this fear, okay? So, wow, mine is going to be open on rare earths and we know that they are highly contaminant. We should think in terms of global size, okay? Earth now, and we are global, okay? All human beings, we are global. So if we allow that the exploitation is taking place in countries that they are not subjected to strong regulations, environmental regulations, we will all pay for that. And that is reality. We will pay for that. The complete environment will pay for that, and we will be all affected by that situation. So it's much better that there is the opportunity of opening new mines in countries, in continents, where there is a strong regulation in terms of environmental protection. That is the way to go. Here I write some rare free permanent magnet alternatives. I write some because it's true that there are many materials that are on systems that are currently under research, but I like to focus on those that at the moment they are promising and they are already in some industrial trials. Okay? So I wrote here present alternatives, so improved ferrites, and also the possibility of combining neodymium and boron with ferrite to try to reduce the use. Then short medium term, manganese, aluminum, carbon. And I include here also the possibility of advancing also in the technological path, okay, through 3D printing of magnets. Then we have also permanent magnets that in the long term, they may be substitutes not only for bonded neodymium iron boron, so for the lower scale neodymium iron boron magnets, but actually they will be able of competing in the complete application range with neodymium iron boron sintered magnets, okay, the strongest ones. And that is this order phase of iron nickel that it is actually found only in some meteorites. In the case of manganese, aluminum, carbon, and manganese bismuth, I wrote it in brackets because there are some concerns in terms of bismuth content, okay, for this material. But also ferrites and these hybrid materials, they are aiming to substitute bonded neodymium iron boron magnets, okay? And that will mean a huge market sector, okay? Already the substitution of this bonded neodymium iron boron, isotropic and anisotropic, will mean a breakthrough. So that is something very important. And then we have this another order phase, which it will take long time, okay, before it can be developed. And actually, we're working in a project. It's a small European project. And in the group, Alonso, Cristina, and Esther, they are doing research on different approaches to try to synthesize this material that is only found in some meteorites to be able of synthesizing artificially in the laboratory. In this presentation, I will focus on ferrites and on manganese aluminum. And this is something important, okay? So when you want to prepare a dish, the first thing you need is good ingredients. Actually, you require excellent ingredients if you want to prepare a very nice dish. Actually, this is a typical cocido madrileño, okay? It's a typical dish from Madrid. Very tasty, by the way. And you have in between the ingredients and finalizing this, the cooking process, okay? that is as important as starting from good ingredients, and actually is the way how you are transforming, okay, these ingredients into the final dish. In the case of the preparation of permanent magnets, as I write here, cooking permanent magnets, we have a similar situation. You need to start for excellent intrinsic magnetic properties, okay? Saturation magnetization, anisotropy field, and the curie temperature that indicates you or gives you the limit of application for those permanent magnets in terms of temperature, operating temperature. Then you want to finish with a magnet with excellent properties, okay? These extrinsic properties, which are the properties you are going to use in your specific application. Okay? So they are remanence, coercivity, and the energy density, which is the figure of merit, okay, which is giving you the quality of the magnet. But in the middle, you have this cooking process. The cooking process is to be able of controlling the microstructure, and also, especially relevant for some systems, to control the phase transformation. Okay. This is just a remark, okay? So this is the hysteresis loop we have seen before. During this presentation, usually what I will show you is the second quadrant of the hysteresis loop to pay attention to remanence and coercivity, which at the end they are giving us this BH mass, okay? This energy, maximum energy product, which is the figure of merit for permanent magnets. So I will start with strontium ferrite, okay? And the importance of controlling the microstructure to end with a good permanent magnet. What I'm going to show you, usually I show this at the end, okay? But I want to start now. So what I am going to explain you is, how is possible, starting from a material, this is a commercial strontium ferrite, with a coercivity below 1 kilohersted, to end with a coercivity above 3 kilohersted, okay? So in the process I am going to show you now, we have been able of multiplying by 3 the coercivity of a commercial product, okay? This example, it is true, is a low-grade strontium ferrite, but the results I am going to show you now, we have tested with low-grade and high-grade ferrites, and we are able every time to increase coercivity, okay, to values that are above 3 kilohersted. What is the context of the research? So how we started this research on strontium ferrite? Actually, this was part of a European project in 2012 that was involving also, okay, different partners. We were 13 partners. It was also coordinated as passengers since from IMDEA, Nanociencia. And when visiting a company in Barcelona, okay, so they are very, very, very near to us. When you are taking the train, you are there in less than 3 hours, you are there. So when visiting them, we saw this, you know, this mixture of water, ferrite powder, some oil that they are using in the cutting machines. And I was asking Ricardo, the director of the company, what they were doing with this material that was coming from cutting magnets, okay? Because this is the magnets they produce, but maybe the customer requires that the length of this magnet is reduced for the specific application, so they need to cut the magnet. So when asking, he told me that they were throwing it away. So to fulfill the regulations, of course, they were contracting a company, and this company was taking the residue, and it was taken away. They didn't know what it was taken away, okay? But it was completely removed from there, and actually paying money, of course, okay? So we started to consider how it would be possible to guarantee sustainability in the production of these ferrite magnets. Of course, when you are talking about recycling, and you go to a company, and you talk to them about diminishing the impact on the environment, this is sounding very nice. But at the end, as I read here, money talks, and reality is that ferrites are extremely cheap. And they are really very cheap. So the premise is to manage a successful recycling process that could be implemented in the company was first to make use of the existing facilities in the company. If they will require to buy new equipment, that will be already a reason to disregard the recycling process. Then to use comparable parameters, because we all know that every watt that is used in the production, okay, any increase in the electric consumption will mean a huge bill for the company, okay? And then also, and this is the main point at the very end, the quality of the recycled material should not be inferior to that of the new material, because otherwise cannot be re-entered, or it may be re-entered to produce lower quality products, okay? So these were the three premises that we had in mind. So as you can see here on the left-hand side, we are starting to do research in the lab. So we took with us part of this residue, this paste, okay, this oily, wet paste, and we were doing some different treatments, okay, some heating, some thermal treatments, also some mechanical approaches, but we were working with milligrams, right? But what we did, what I'm going to show you afterwards, we did the upscaling. So we moved, okay, to the company, to IMA, Ingeniería Magnética Aplicada is the name, and we did it in situ, and we demonstrate in situ with kilograms of material that it was possible. So this is the second quadrant of the hysteresis loop for the commercial ferrite, the starting material. This is not the residue, the waste. This is the starting material. This is coming from here, as I was telling you before, from cutting magnets, okay? And it's taken from this mixture. This is already what we observe when drying this material. We need it to dry because, for example, to take it to the magnetometer to record this hysteresis loop, okay, we needed to dry the material. What was our surprise when we realized that only by drying at 250 degrees the material, we were already improving the magnetic properties, okay? So the first question was, wow, how is it possible to manage this improvement? And here you have the answer, okay? And this is a good example of the effect of the microstructure. This is the microstructure, okay, taken with the scanning electron microscope of the new commercial ferrite. And this is the image of the waste after drying. So you see that there is a clear microstructural refinement during the process. As I was telling you before, this is coming from cutting the magnets. When you are cutting one of these magnets, they are very brittle. That means that you need to cut them slowly, and you cannot cut big pieces at once. You need to be cutting almost closing to a polishing procedure. Okay? So already during that process, they were refining the microstructure and they were increasing the magnetic properties. Actually, if you check the X-ray patterns, you see exactly the same phases there. So all the intensity peaks that they are not indicated, they correspond to strontium ferrite. And the red ones, they correspond to iron 203, okay, which is one of the constituents that it is used in the synthesis of strontium ferrite. And you find it very typically in strontium ferrite magnets. So you have the mixture of both strontium ferrite and some minority content of this iron 203. But as you can see here, there is an increased width in the intensity of the diffraction peaks. As you know, this increased widthness of the peaks means that you are decreasing also not only the particle size, but also the grain size. Actually, you can see here, the commercial ferrite, the starting, the brand new material, has a mean grain size above 100 nanometers, the dried residue about 40 nanometers. So you see, in the cutting process, they were refining the microstructure, not only the particle size, but also the grain size. And also after calcination, because we did also calcination, we are increasing. Of course, you go from 250 degrees to 1,000 degrees, so the grain size is also increasing. And as a consequence of this, the drying and this calcination process at 1,000 degrees, we were able of increasing the coercivity up to 3.3 kilo-oersted. Okay, here you have the comparison of the microstructure, again, the commercial powder, the brand new one, this black curve, and also the waste after calcinating. So you see here, these are aggregates of smaller particles. So you see you have very fine particles. Actually, they are in the range of 100 nanometers, between 50 nanometers and 100 nanometers, because they are really very, very fine. So that means that we were able of increasing coercivity in 3.5 times larger. As I was mentioning before, if you consider that the single domain size for strontium ferrite is 900 nanometers, then you may find the explanation why we're increasing coercivity so much when we manage to reduce, okay, particle size and also grain size in such a way. But then we were thinking, well, very interesting. So let's do an experiment. What about refining the commercial material through a milling process in the lab, okay? So what I have shown you before is You have the waste, you do some thermal treatments, and then you realize that during the processing, they refine the microstructure, and during thermal annealing, okay, thermal treatment, we are developing the final microstructure. But now we decided, okay, let's take this commercial powder that we have here, and let's do some milling experiments to try to find out if we are able of reproducing this that is produced during the cutting. So we decided to do that by what I call here ultrafast milling. This is a method that we have developed, okay, in the group, and is permitting to go to milling times in the range of 30 seconds to 45 minutes. Okay, we have applied successfully to cobalt ferrite and also to manganese aluminum. And here we have, okay, the second quadrant of the hysteresis loop for the starting material, and in blue, you see the waste calcinating. This is the result I showed you before. Now, let's do the milling of this starting material. After 1.5 minutes, wow, you see, we have managed to increase a lot coercivity and also remanence. Let's increase the milling time. Let's go to double time, 3 minutes. In 3 minutes, you see that we were able of practically reproducing the same loop that we have after the recycling process. Actually, if you compare the microstructure, this is the brand new material on the left-hand side. This is the recycled material, and this is the material that we have started from this starting, okay? We have started from the commercial powder, sorry, and we have thus these ball milling experiments. So you see that we have particle size that are very similar. In terms of the X-ray diffraction pattern, again, you see a strontium ferrite intensity peaks, and then these red triangles are indicating iron 203. So we have been able of fulfilling the three premises. Same facilities that they are using, comparable parameters, because 1000 degree is the temperature range that companies working with ferrites, they are using for sintering the final magnets, and also for the production of the composition of the strontium iron 203. And also the quality of the recycled material, you see that it's not only that it's not inferior, okay, to the starting one, but also it's better. Okay, we have developed a material that is better, not that the waste is better than the starting, that the commercial one that they are acquiring. Can we do it any better? Actually, yes. We have been able of improving the process. So this is the result I have shown you before, going to 3.3 kilohertz. And now we are able of going close to 5 kilohertz. And actually, when starting from different ferrites, we have been able of achieving the 6 kilohertz coercivity. Okay, so we are at present in this value of coercivity by the development of a new nanocomposite product, which at the end is we have managed to improve the coupling between the strontium ferrite and the iron 203, the iron oxide that we have there. Technological innovation. Okay, first thing, when you compare a commercial ferrite, which has a large particle size, with this improved ferrite powder that we have developed with very fine particle size, you see that this change in the granulometry is going to have an influence. And the influence is when you want to prepare new magnets, you do not need to change the machine, but you need to change the molds, because otherwise the powder will come in between the walls because it's so fine. So we redesigned the tools, and that was very useful to prepare magnets that actually at the end of the project, we integrated in the motor. The motor is here, okay, in this back wheel of this motorbike, okay? So this is an electric motorbike where we have substituted the neodymium iron boron magnet motor for a ferrite, exclusively ferrite ones. So here you have, this is the schematic of the rotor. So you have, here you see these segments, are these segments made out of improved ferrite magnets. So there are 16 here and 16 facing that disc. Okay, here you have a magnification of one of these segments. So that was done in the frame of the project. This is how they were mounted, okay, in the motor. And actually, I will show you the motorbike. So you can see, these were all the partners making the consortium. Okay, so here you can see the motorbike. I always like to mention when watching this video, the motorbike is a standard size. The point is that this Danish scientist is very tall, eh? So don't think that this is a toy motorbike, it's a real motorbike. Okay, so you can see there that is the motor completely made out of ferrite. Now, going smaller, you may remember the movie, it's a movie that I remember with a lot of cariño from when I was a child, okay, Fantastic Voyage, okay? When these scientists were going inside of this submarine, okay, this sort of submarine, and they were in the bloodstream and they were traveling. As I used to mention, also there is the movie, this is from 1966, and there is another movie, similar topic, okay, from 1987, that young people, they are more familiar with this one. Not everybody is familiar with this, which actually this movie from 1966 was inspiring a book by Isaac Asimov, okay? I was surprised at the time because I thought that further was coming the book, but no, the movie inspired the book to Isaac Asimov. So why I am showing you this? Well, you have seen that motor that we did for the motorbike. That was, as I was mentioning before, made out of ferrite. Now we are working in a project, okay, again with different partners. This project is coordinated by Universidad de Alcalá, also in Madrid, in Spain, and we count with the participation of companies like Boston Scientific. Okay? And the idea is to try to make this motor as small as this, okay, as you can see here. So the motor will have a diameter of 0.3 millimeters. Okay? So it's going to be really tiny. And the idea is to try to put it together to a catheter to be able of moving inside of the body to make some cardiovascular surgery, micro surgery. Right? So this is a very challenging project. This is, I will say, together with the one related to the synthesis of this meteoritic phase, the most challenging project that we have now in the group. We have the main scientists that are working from our group, okay, in this project. So the idea is to put it together here. And of course, one of the ideas in the future is, even in the future, not in the near future, to be able of removing the catheter and to be able of doing something like in those movies I was showing you before, okay? So to be able of diving, of going like a submarine inside of the body to make this surgery. Now I would like to go fast on manganese aluminum, but I would like that you keep this idea, okay? I wanted to start with the ferrite and with that specific case because I think it's a clear example of how important is the microstructure to be able of tuning the magnetic properties, and in that particular case of really improving the magnetic properties of the magnetic material. In the case of manganese aluminum, you have another thing, another point, another tool, okay, coming into play. And that is the possibility of controlling the phase transformation. So now we are going to play with the microstructure and with the phase transformation. We have been working on two different systems in the past, manganese aluminum and manganese bismuth. What I'm going to show you is focus mainly on manganese aluminum. Okay? Melek Villanueva and Javier Rial, they already completed the PhD. So, okay, so now we are different people also working on these systems. Carla is doing the PhD work on this material, and actually she's completely sponsored by a company. And this is something very interesting because the results I'm going to show you, they called, okay, the attention of a company that they were trying to make some trials with manganese aluminum, and they found so interesting the possibility of improving the magnetic properties that they decided to sign a contract. Actually, we are now with a second contract to go further in the development of the permanent magnet properties of this material. This material is very interesting because of the possibility of achieving a high maximum energy product that will be able of competing with bond and neodymium iron boron magnets, a low density, okay? So the density is lower than the one that you have for neodymium iron boron. That will mean the possibility of doing lighter magnets. And then, very important, manganese and aluminum, they are very much available in the particular case of Europe, but all around the world, okay, you can find resources of manganese and aluminum. In the case of Spain, Spain is one of the world producers of manganese, with two mines that are in Granada, okay, in the south of Spain. So it was also very interesting from a national point of view, to say, wow, we have here really very large natural resources for this material. This, I will not go into detail of this phase diagram. Actually, I wrote here in brackets phase diagram because I have included here the tau phase. The tau phase is a meta-stable phase. And this phase is extremely important in the case of manganese aluminum because it is the only ferromagnetic phase. It's the phase we need so the material can behave as a permanent magnet. Okay? As it is metastable, if you are checking for rigorously the phase diagram, you will not find it there. Okay? Now, I am going to show you how is fabricated the material that we are using. The material that we are using is gas atomized manganese aluminum carbon powder. And the technique actually is very much based on how these lead shots, okay, we call them in Spanish perdigones, they are fabricated. Okay? And actually, this gentleman, William Watts, patented the process for making this lead shot. And he did it by pouring molten lead through a sieve to form balls and allow them to fall from a height into water, resulting in these perfect shaped lead balls. Okay? So what they were doing is, this was the first shot tower in the world. Okay? It was done by the gentleman, William Watts. And here from top, he was pouring the melt, okay, through a sieve, and then through this path, okay, this free path, falling in finally into water to have this spherical shape. Actually, we have also one of these Torre de los Perdigones, okay, is the equivalent, that was created in 1885, and it's the same principle. Okay, so the melt is following. This path is giving you the final dimensions of these balls, okay, and at the end there is water where they become quenched, they become solidified. Okay? In the case of gas atomization, how we are producing in the collaboration, this manganese aluminum powder is the same. You have the melt, here you have a cold finger, which is actually argon, so in contact with them they become solidified and they have this free path, okay, where finally they are cooling down to have at the end this powder that we see there. Okay? So this is the starting material. So we have gas atomized, manganese aluminum carbon. We are starting from epsilon phase. And you will tell me, yeah, but you said that only the tau phase is ferromagnetic. Yeah, you're right. But we cannot produce tau phase by gas atomization. So by gas atomization, we will have epsilon phase. That will be our precursor. Most of the studies, as I read here, typically focus on trying to develop 100% tau phase. If you have 100% of this ferromagnetic phase, you will achieve maximum magnetization. But the problem is coming with coercivity. You will have a coercivity that is typically below 1.5 kilohertz, okay, which is useless for technological applications. Okay? So what we are doing is to apply milling and annealing. Okay? By milling, we are able not only of making smaller the particles, but we are acting on the microstructure. Okay? We are creating a stress. We are also controlling the phase transformation. And then it's during the annealing where we are able of doing this final tuning of the phases that we will have. I am going to show you. This is, again, the second quadrant of the hysteresis loop for the starting material. This is manganese aluminum carbon produced by gas atomization. So in the beginning, we have the epsilon phase, and we did an annealing to transform it to tau phase. Okay? Otherwise, you will not have this magnetic response. At the moment where you have this magnetic response, that means that you have there your tau phase. Now, what we were doing is to mill, okay? So you see, we start to increase coercivity. This is after 30 seconds of milling, and then heating up, annealing at 525 degrees Celsius. So 30 seconds, 60 seconds, 90 seconds, 120 seconds, 180, and 240 seconds. So you may realize how much we are increasing the coercivity of this starting material. And actually, when you look to the X-ray pattern, you see this is the tau phase, these red stars, and then you see these blue circles that I have included here, okay? Actually, Carla was preparing this slide today to show you in a clearer manner how is the evolution that you have. So with increasing milling time and after annealing, you see that this phase, this beta phase, is increasing. This beta phase is very important because it's acting as pinning centers during magnetization reversal. In other words, when we are reversing the field, that is what we are doing here to measure the hysteresis loop, the magnetic moments, they find there in the moment when they are turning to be trying to be parallel to the magnetic field, the external magnetic field that we are applying, they find out in the way pinning centers. These pinning centers actually, and this is in a very intuitive manner what I am explaining you, is this beta phase. So this beta phase is preventing a rapid, okay, reversal of the magnetization, and it's making that we manage to increase coercivity in this material. And this is what was calling the attention of in particular, this company I was telling you before, and we established this great and very nice collaboration that we keep with them to improve the magnetic properties of the material that they are producing by gas atomization. And then we are handling to be able of modifying microstructure phases and accordingly the magnetic properties. We went one step further. Okay, this is a work that we did together with the Institute. Actually, this is the Institute IFW where I was doing my PhD, and it's also in collaboration with the company Hoganas, okay, the one we are collaborating. And the idea was, okay, what I will have shown you before is the powder, but we are interested on magnets, okay? We are not interested on the powder itself, but we want magnets that can be integrated in application. As I mentioned, epsilon phase is not ferromagnetic. So typically what you need to do is to go from epsilon phase through annealing to this tau phase, and then you go through compact of this powder in presence of temperature to finally have this tau phase magnet. And what we did was a simplified process. Okay, the simplified process was, well, okay, we are going to apply pressure and temperature, so then let's start from epsilon phase. Let's optimize this process and to end directly with a magnet. So you are compacting this powder, and at the same time, you are easing this phase transformation from epsilon to tau. And actually, here you have in blue is the starting powder once has been transformed to tau phase. Okay, as I was telling you before, otherwise you will not have this ferromagnetic response. So it's tau phase. And this is the comparison of the process we did, this one-step process, with the typical two-step process that will be used to produce the magnet. So they basically overlap. We have very comparable results. And this was very successful as part of a publication. And actually, Carla was getting an award in the last EMRS conference because of this approach that we were developing together with these other centers. And this drives to this project that Luis was mentioning before, Passenger. Based on those results and some others, but those are key results, and together also with experience and other results achieved by other research centers, okay, in the framework of different European projects, Passenger was started. Passenger is a European initiative that is combining two 20 partners, putting them together, 14 companies from 8 different countries. The goal, the main objective, is to secure a sustainable industrial solution to Europe's strategic dependence on rare earth elements using magnets. It's very much aligned with the Green Deal. It's something that in Europe now we have a lot of support to try to advance in electromobility, green energy, well, renewable energies. Okay, and the aim of this project is the establishment of 8 pilot plants in Europe by 2025. Okay. So it's a project, it's beautiful because it means the translation of research done in the laboratory to fabrication, okay, in different pilot plants. Has a large budget, okay, because it requires a lot of funding to be able of doing this. And actually the final objective is integration of the magnets that we will develop, okay, in electromobility applications. So in particular, we will develop electric bikes, electric motorbikes, and also substitution in different automatics, okay, appliances in the cars. Okay, in particular for that, we count also with the participation of Fiat, okay, the CRF, which is the research center of Fiat, and also smaller companies like Tizona Motors, that they will be responsible of doing these other electric vehicles. Just to conclude my presentation, I will go very quickly on the technological advances that we've done on additive manufacturing. additive manufacturing, you know, is very much extended in different sectors. But in the case of permanent magnets, there is still plenty of work to do, because when going to techniques or to approaches like selective laser melting, that they are very much established in the fabrication, for example, as you can see here, titanium prostheses, right? Another components like this one, is different in the case of permanent magnets. In the case of permanent magnets, the local temperature that you achieve during the fabrication of these components is too high and is destroying the permanent magnet properties, because it's destroying the microstructure, okay, that is providing those properties. So because of that, techniques like these ones, they need to be very much improved and modified when they want to be applied to the fabrication of permanent magnets. These are 7 families of additive manufacturing, and the particular one we are focusing is on this one, okay? This is fused filament fabrication. Why we are focusing on this one? Because that technique, this one, is making possible to control the temperature processing during the printing, okay? So in such a way that you do not destroy, and actually, as I will show you, you do not deteriorate the permanent magnet properties. So we are preparing composites, okay, for the extrusion of a final filament. So you have here polymer, you have the permanent magnet polymer. So we are able of preparing composites, okay, in this way, or it can be done in the shape of pellets. Actually, commercial pellets, they can be found in this shape in order to print different elements. And we do every step, okay? We go from the synthesis of the composite to the extrusion of the filament. So all these images have been taken here at IMDEA in our laboratory, and also to the printing of magnetic components. Usually when you buy, because you can buy pellets that they are combining polymer and permanent magnet, for example, strontium ferrite, neodymium iron boron, but they are typically that by mechanical methods, okay? So they are feeding the polymer and the permanent magnet, they go through this rotating screw, so at the end you have these pellets. The problem is that you are limited to the type of polymer, and also you cannot avoid the formation of aggregates, okay? We are able of overcoming those disadvantages and actually going further, because we can select the polymer that is best suited to our particular application. Okay, so Daniel, Javier, and Esther, they are working a great work in the group to prepare these, okay, composites by the solution casting method. And here you have the example of one of these composites. Actually, this is manganese aluminum carbon with one of the polymers. Okay, here you have, okay, the combination of the polymer, magnetic powder, and the composite. And this has been done with manganese aluminum carbon. Also, it has been tried with materials that they are not used for permanent magnets, okay? Aluminum and steel. And that is very good. This with in collaboration with another company that is working on aerospace applications. This is very good, because this means that the technology that you are developing in the laboratory, you can extend it to different applications, okay? In this case, it was for aerospace applications. And now, also, we have started, right, to consider the application of this technique, of this method, right, for the fabrication of prostheses, and in particular, implants to be used in the human body, okay? And also on solid cells, solid fuel cells. So I told you before, we have done it with ferrites. These are examples, okay? This is the mixture, okay, of the polymer, and here you have strontium ferrite and also neodymium iron boron. And also in the case of manganese aluminum, this is the cross section of this filament where you have particles of manganese aluminum and you have the polymer. Here you can see better. This is the composite, and you see that we are tuning the filling factor, okay? The amount of manganese aluminum that we have mixed with the polymer. That is very good, because it means that we can tune the permanent magnetic properties, okay? The most amount of material that you have on manganese aluminum, the highest will be the magnetic performance, of course. If you have 5% of manganese aluminum, that will be basically a polymer, a magnetic polymer, but with a very poor response. So this is the possibility of increasing. And actually, this is one of the very important points of this research, the possibility of going to a filling factor above 88%. Okay? That is what is critical in this research. And here, as you can see, we have a comparison of the second quadrant of the hysteresis loop of the starting powder, the composite, okay, and the filament. Okay? It's normalized with the filling factor to show you that there is no deterioration of the magnetic properties through the complete process, the composite synthesis, and also the filament extrusion. Okay? Again, you have the cross-section, so you see that the material is very homogeneous, and we have managed even to optimize, okay, this homogeneity by combining different particle sizes. Okay? Here you have an example, a picture. This is the filament, the magnetic filament, and we are handling, okay, permanent magnets in our hands, so you see how it's attracted. Actually, this was the first time that it was reported, the synthesis of a rare earth-free permanent magnet filament. And not only this was manganese aluminum, but the first time of a rare earth-free permanent magnet filament with such a high content of permanent filament and prepared by this chemical method of solution casting. This is the proof of concept. Actually, these are the feed from one of our researchers, Dr. Esther Palmero. And here you can see these are based purely polymer pieces. And this is a component with some permanent magnet material inside, and we are doing it in different shapes. So I am going to conclude this. I think I was a bit too long, but I hope that you have enjoyed. So basically, gap magnets will enable very soon the partial substitution of rare earth-based magnet in specific technological applications. And as I have told you before, we are aiming at substitution even if in small electric vehicles. Right? Ferrites and manganese aluminum, they are very good candidates to become these gap magnets that will provide to fill this gap. That problem at present is completely filled by the neodymium iron boron. We are able of controlling through different techniques, okay, gas atomization, flash milling, optimized annealing treatments, the microstructure and the phase evolution in manganese aluminum, and this is very important if you will want to end with real permanent magnets. And then additive manufacturing, in the case of permanent magnets, is still developing and has a long and very exciting way to go into final applications. So I would like to conclude with this my presentation, and of course to thank you very much for your attention. Thank you.
Thanks for the interesting talk, Alberto. I will invite all to unmute the microphone so that we can thank the speaker.
Thank you.
This section is now open for questions, so you can raise your hand using the Zoom button so that you can ask questions. So maybe I can do a first one. So when you did the milling process and you were able to move the magnetization curve to larger magnet field in absolute values, do you understand from the microscope point of view what happens to the sample? Why this happens, this behavior?
Yeah, yeah. Well, in the case of strontium ferrite, when you compare the evolution of the X-ray patterns that you have at the different milling times, you can really see that you have this grain size reduction. Also, you have something very important. You are inducing a stress. That stress that you are inducing in the microstructure, it has also an effect. Okay? In the case of the strontium ferrite, it's directly the stress itself that is providing also this increase in the coercivity. In the case of manganese aluminum, is promoting the formation also of the beta phase. Okay? Is this thing that in one system, you really do not need to play with additional phases, but in the another one, you are able of combining, okay, this second role, that the phase that in principle is not magnetic, the beta phase, but can be very advantageous to develop coercivity, which is missing, okay, which is missing in a purely tau phase material, manganese aluminum.
Okay, thanks. So, Roberto, please.
First, thank you for a very nice talk and this very important topic. A The strontium ferrite is very interesting that you're recycling the waste of the industry. I was interested to understand what happens with the alpha iron 203, I think that is hematite. Is that coming from the calcination, or was already there in the powder or in the cut sample?
I will share again my screen. That is a very good question. That is a really very good question. So, okay, here it is. Okay, I will try to skip the... Okay, just 1 second. Well, in the meanwhile, I will reply you. You have in the starting material, you already have, okay, iron 203. That is what I am going to show you now. I am going to go directly to the slide. Naturally, I will show you with this example. I was telling you that we were ball milling the material to really analyze what was happening during the process. So you have some iron 203, some hematite, already in the starting material. But during the ball milling, when you are increasing the milling time, okay, you have the generation of additional iron 203. So because of that, what we have observed is when we are increasing milling times, like let's say 20, 25 minutes, we go to coercivities actually up to 6 kilohertz, okay? But you are decreasing magnetization. You are decreasing magnetization, and I will try now to share the screen here. Show you. Okay, here it is. Okay, I will not make it bigger because then it's easier to shift along them. So the commercial calcinated, for example, this is the starting material that we were doing also some calcination. Do you see these red triangles? Can you see my screen at the moment?
Yes.
Okay,
yes,
so this. Perfect. These red triangles, they are the hematite, okay? The iron 203. These triangles, they are already present in the starting material, in the commercial one. When we are doing the milling, you see, we move now here, or this one, okay, already this one. Milled 1.5 minutes, you see that we are increasing the amount of iron 203. When we are milling for longer time, 3 minutes, this quantity is increased even further. We have done millings for 20, 25 minutes, as I was telling you before, and the amount of iron 203 is increasing. With that, we are able of increasing coercivity, but then there is a point where you start to decrease magnetization because of the disadvantage, okay, you have iron 203, then it's not any longer ferrimagnetic, you are talking about antiferromagnetic contribution that is diminishing the magnetization. So it's playing a very important role, but you need to control very well. Okay, it depends what is going to be your final product. In the case of strontium ferrite, one of the main disadvantages of this material is the reduced coercivity at low temperatures. Okay? On the other hand, when you are going to high temperatures, it's a very particular material because together with manganese bismuth, they are the two permanent magnets that the coercivity is increasing with temperature. In the case of neodymium iron boron, you have a decreased coercivity when you are increasing the temperature. But that is different in the case of ferrite and manganese bismuth. But as I was telling you before, when you start to decrease the temperature, the coercivity of ferrite decreases and goes to very low values. That is a problem when you want to use these magnets in cold environments. Okay? For example, if you want to use this motor made of ferrite in a very cold environment, and you have traditional ferrite, you have the possibility of the danger that becomes the magnetized because of the temperature. What is the solution for that? Well, for that, there is a solution that was coming from a patent from TDK in 1998, which is to dope the strontium ferrite with lanthanum and with cerium, okay? If you are doping the strontium ferrite, you are able of increasing the coercivity. Okay, so in such a way that at low temperatures, you maintain some still efficient coercivity. Another approach that we are doing here is, well, okay, let's try to find a compromise between the content of hematite and the content of strontium ferrite to start from a very high coercivity, because we are aware that we are going to lose coercivity when going to lose temperature. But since we are starting for some, from such a high value, it is not so critical, okay? So because of that, I was telling you that is a very good question, because iron 203 is playing a very important role. It's not only a question of microstructural refinement, but also of this presence of iron 203.
Thank you.
Gabriel, please.
Well, good morning. First, thanks for the presentation. And I would like to know if is your research group purely experimental, or are there some theorists with you, working with you?
Thank you, Gabriel. Actually, that is one of the weak points we have in the group. There is not any theoretician, okay? That is one of these open gaps we have. We are collaborating with theoreticians, okay? Because in all these projects, at the end, you have a lot of experimentalists and a few theoreticians, because there are not so many theoreticians working on permanent magnets, okay? And we keep collaborations with them. This is especially important in the case of the iron-nickel phase, okay? This exotic, extraordinary phase I was telling you in the beginning, because we know, and when I say we know, is the scientific community, we know so little about this phase that we need the support from theoreticians to make some modeling and to try to provide us information how we can increase the atomic diffusion to form that extraordinary hard magnetic phase. So, Gabriel, if you are a theoretician and you are thinking of coming to Spain, you are very much welcome.
Oh, thank you, thank you.
Luis Eugenio.
I would like to thank you for this very nice talk that I enjoyed so much, and that I learned a lot. But I would like to ask you two questions, okay? One is about the role of carbon in the manganese aluminum alloy. And the other one is that if the increase the proportion of the beta phase that increases coercivity, that phase is also responsible for that reduction in magnetization that you see at a certain point.
Yeah. Okay. So the role of carbon is to stabilize the tau phase. The tau phase is a metastable phase, right? So the carbon, actually, we are using, typically, the research groups working with manganese, aluminum, carbon, we are all using about 1 to 2 atomic percent. Okay? So it's a minor content, but it is very important to stabilize the tau phase, okay? In temperature, especially in temperature. Then about the beta phase, that is the key point. You need to be able of finding the optimum content of beta phase. Beta phase is not ferromagnetic. So as you mentioned, you are decreasing magnetization. You're decreasing saturation magnetization, because actually I have not here, and Carla will tell me later, but I sent you also the complete hysteresis loop. Yeah, she is correct, but I didn't include them here. So you see that there is an increase in remanence, but when you are going to the saturation magnetization, this one, okay, the manganese aluminum carbon, the starting one with a very low beta phase content, is the one with the highest saturation magnetization, okay? And it's because of that. This is like the glass of water. You can put as much water as the volume of the glass. So if you have everything full of tau, you will have very high saturation magnetization, but low coercivity. If you start to substitute part of that tau phase by a small content of beta phase, yeah, you begin to increase coercivity, but you are losing saturation magnetization, okay? So the point is, how much saturation are you willing to sacrifice to increase coercivity? Because we were able of achieving coercivities above 5 kilohertz, okay? Very high coercivities. but with a very low magnetization that is also useless for applications, okay? So at the end, what you need, in this case, is very good. It's very good because you see that we are able of increasing coercivity, but remanence has also increased. And it has increased because during this annealing that we are doing, we are influencing the ordering of this tau phase, okay? So let's say during the milling, you, in addition to create additional secondary phases, you disorder this tau phase. And during this annealing, you reorder the tau phase, so you are able of increasing. Another approach that we are doing now is, instead of sacrificing tau phase to generate beta phase, let's keep the tau phase, but let's introduce some carbides. Okay? If you think about it, manganese, aluminum, carbon, if you are looking at the elements, not the composition, the elements, you have the manganese, you have the aluminum, and you have carbon, but you have steels that contain these elements. Okay, actually, they are also part of this lightweight structural steel. So they are steels. And what are they using in the steels fabrication? Carbides. Carbides are very good for mechanical strength. Carbides are very good to achieve very good properties while you are decreasing the weight of the steel. Right? So what we are doing now is to try to translate part of that knowledge that there is on steels. Actually, this company we're working with traditionally is working on steels manufacturing. And actually what they wanted to do is that we are working with steel manufacturing and we are interested on checking how this knowledge and how this expertise and equipment, they can be translated to prepare now permanent magnets. Okay, so if you are able of retaining, let's say, practically 100% of your tau phase and introducing some elements, okay, to act as this beta phase, you will have the ideal situation. Okay, we didn't achieve it yet, but we are working on that direction.
Thank you.
More questions, comments? Roberto.
I have a fast question. About calcination, when you talk about calcination and heat treatment, are you doing that in atmosphere or in oxygen or in nitrogen atmosphere? And in both cases, I mean.
In air.
Strontium ferrite and the magnesium aluminum.
Okay. In the case of strontium ferrite, that is one of the nicest things, it's already oxidized. So we do everything in air. That is fantastic, you know? Especially one of the technicians, of the young technicians that is working with us, Cristina, she started to work with manganese aluminum. So she needed to do everything in protective atmosphere. Okay? So we are doing the annealing in nitrogen atmosphere. And that is also answering to your second question in terms of manganese aluminum. So manganese aluminum in protective atmosphere. In particular, we use nitrogen. But in the case of ferrite, when we switch to ferrite, and then she was doing the experiments in air, she was happy, she was very happy, you know? Because she didn't need to use the glove box or the air lines, the nitrogen line in the furnace, but everything in air.
Thank you.
Luis Eugenio, do you have another question or you just kept it? Yes?
I want to ask something else, okay. Which is not about physics really, but I'm really impressed because of the amount of industrial collaboration that you've got, okay? And I would like to know if you could tell me, what is the average time it takes normally since you start the first contact with the companies, yeah, to get the project running? What is typically that time? Does it vary a lot from one company to another, or is it is that distribution narrow or is it large? And what's the typical average time?
That is a good question, Luis. That is a good question. It depends very much. The first thing I will tell you, it depends very much on the characteristics of the call you are applying for an international call. If the funding for the companies is 100%, it will take you short time, you know, to make them involved. But there are very few calls here in Europe that they are providing 100% of the funding also to companies. Usually you have a funding rate of 70%, which still is very advantageous for companies. Okay. Is easy? No, it is not easy. So you need to go through different meetings with them. For example, in the genesis of Passenger, in the creation of Passenger, I had different meetings. So sometimes you have a meeting when you are talking with five different persons from that company, you know, from the director to technicians to marketing people. So they need to know why that project is going to be positive for them. So you need to leave them very clear why. It is different in the case of Hoganas, okay, the company that we have the contract for manganese aluminum, because they were clear what is the profit to them. So it was easier. Okay? Even with that, I think always the approach is, and that we are doing it, we have started another industrial project for recycling 1 week ago with a Spanish company. Okay, what is the approach? The approach is, okay, we can do a proof of concept free of charge. So it is interesting for the company, it is interesting for the group, because always you are learning something. When you are able of demonstrating them that you can improve the product or that you can create a new product, then they are willing to as I used to say, to commit. Okay, is this point when you are meeting them and you say, well, you know, I think now it's time for a commitment. To talk about money is dirty. Cost is a bit more elegant, but then you say a commitment. We should establish a commitment, okay? Yeah. So we have demonstrated a proof of concept, so let's go for something else. So then I think it's rather easy. So as you have said, we have many, it is not only collaboration, but they are contracts, so they are projects, so they are really putting funding by themselves, okay, to do the research. In all the projects I have mentioned, there are companies and they get some funding, but they are making use of their own funding. But they are clear that the profit that they can get is very interesting. It's very interesting to them. Even some of them, if you want to go to the other extreme, maybe they are hesitating, but they find that the proposal is so interesting that they are thinking, hey, what could happen if something coming out from here and we are not in, you know? So also it's something that you need to tell them. Are you sure you are not going to take part in this proposal? Are you going to miss it? Okay, so it's a question of how to say, of demonstrating all the things that you can do for them.
Yeah.
And in terms of time, Luis, it's varying a lot, it's changing a lot. For example, for Passenger, for the creation of the consortium, this large consortium, I remember that one of the companies, it was a key company, could not take part in the final proposal. It was two stages, two evaluation stages. In the first one, they were there in the second one, they could not participate because of the situation and some internal reasons. And then you need to move and to try to talk with other people to check how you are going to cover that path, you know, that route. So it may depend. Basically, you need enjoying with that. You need to enjoy talking to them and keeping in mind that you are going to learn even from the meetings, you know, when they tell you what they can do, what they cannot do, you are learning. So it's something interesting.
Very inspiring. Thank you very much, Alberto.
Thank you.
More questions, comments? So I do not see any other hand raised, so I think that's it. Alberto, thanks again for accepting the invitation and for the nice talk.
Thank you very much, Carol.
Okay, I will stop the recording.